Welcome back, folks. We have an exciting discussion this afternoon, a deep dive into understanding and reaching younger audiences. We have a fantastic panel with us today. Before I introduce them, I will just introduce myself. My name is Landon Tulk. I'm a strategy associate with the ZS Associates consulting team in Toronto. I've spent some time with the Premier Ford government in Ontario, and have done some work in the Gen Z and millennial marketing space alongside one of the other panelists today. Before I bring on David from Abacus Data to walk through the trends, perspectives, attitudes of Gen Zs and millennials and to get into the meat of today's discussion, I want to highlight our other panelists. Ginny Roth is the National Practice Lead for Government Relations at Crestview Strategy and a longtime conservative activist, having spent some time at Queen's Park in Toronto and on the campaign front lines with the Ontario PCs. She's had a pulse on younger generations through much of her work and frequently comments on major media throughout the country. Kieran Mathew is another panelist with us today, an entrepreneur, startup advisor, and leading Gen Z marketer behind many notable Fortune 500 and Fortune 1000 marketing campaigns. He's also a recent recipient of the Forbes 30 Under 30 Award in Marketing and Advertising. He'll bring some good perspectives to this conversation on how organizations can work to build better relationships with Gen Zs and millennials. And lastly, David Coletto is the CEO and founding partner of Abacus Data, a full-service market research and strategy firm based in Ottawa and Toronto. He has a PhD in political science from the University of Calgary and is often seen as a leading expert on generational change and millennials in particular. So I'm going to welcome on David now to walk us through his research and insights that he's done with his team to understand Gen Zs and millennials before we move into a panel discussion. David.
Well, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Langdon, thank you for the introduction. I'm really looking forward to the conversation with Kieran and Ginny. I'm going to get right into the presentation. And as Landon said, I've been, you know, spending many years conducting research, looking at how younger Canadians are thinking about issues. We have a semi-annual survey we do of 2,000 basically Canadians between the ages of 18 and 40 that we run every 6 months. And a lot of the data that I'm going to share with you today comes from that Canadian Millennial Report. And in my mind, there's a number of takeaways, I think, for everybody on this webinar today to think about. One is, don't assume that all younger generations and members of younger generations are the same. Folks like me often generalize a lot about, you know, the differences between generations. And I think there's some important ones that I'll highlight today. But we always have to remember that we're talking about millions and millions of Canadians. And there is no way that, you know, the life experience, the outlook, the perspective, the vote behavior of these generations, of members within them are all the same. But I do think there are some really important differences between older generations and younger ones based on two key factors that I'll talk about, which are how we generally were raised and the environment we were raised and the role that technology plays. And so I'll touch on those. I also think that the power of identity for particularly like the Instagram generation is important to think about when it comes to engaging them and getting us to think about the issues that you care about and then turning that interest into actually engagement, I think is really important. Now, I'm going to share a bunch of data on sort of the outlook of this generation, but a takeaway is I think this is a cautiously optimistic generation generally, but one that's increasingly anxious about the future, anxious about their own future as well as the world. And I think that creates both an opportunity and a threat for conservatives to speak to them. And then lastly, I'll leave you with the question that I'm going to kind of end this presentation, which is, what does it say about someone, and this is what they're thinking, what does it say about someone that I or they align with conservative ideas? And how they answer that, I think, becomes really important. So let's get into this. Let me start on slide, I'm going to skip to slide 3, and really look at the generations. And I'm not going to spend a whole lot here, but we're really talking about the two youngest generations right now in the population, those born after 1980. I am, despite looking like maybe barely 21, I'm turning 40 in December. And I am what the New York Times called a geriatric millennial. So I am an old millennial turning 40, but part of what is now the largest generation in the country, representing about 29% of the population. Gen Z, or Gen Z for our American friends, is right behind, born after 2000, and also a significantly large generation. So together, you know, these two generations represent half of the Canadian population. And that number is going to continue to grow, not because of, you know, new naturally born millennials. There won't be any more of us born here in Canada, but immigration is going to continue to increase these two generations. And if we skip to the next slide and we look at these populations over the projected kind of number of years, you can see that we haven't even really reached peak millennial yet. That will happen somewhere in between 2040, 2045. But the point here is that, you know, for any of the boomers on the call, that red line, you know why it goes down. It's just the nature of life. But we're going to be a really, you know, two powerful generations to come politically, economically, socially. And so understanding where we come from and who we are is important. Now, if we skip to the next slide, what we know about, you know, the younger generations in Canada is that it's the most, there will be the most, two most educated generations in history. The stat that I'm always reminded of is these are the millennials are the first generation in which more women will get a post-secondary degree than men. And that's having important and lasting impacts on the nature of households, on who's earning, you know, who are primary earners and what the relationships are in those households themselves. If they are, you know, married or common law or same sex or whatever it is, whatever the composition of those households, it is not what it used to be. And that change is really profound and important when it comes to the issues that these households and these individuals care about. It's also a far more diverse generation. Highest proportion of racialized or visible minority populations in these generations, diverse in terms of their backgrounds and where their parents or where they come from, diverse in terms of their outlooks and the kinds of lives they wanna lead. And so that diversity is something that makes it hard to pin them all down and say they're all the same as well. And then lastly, their ability to be connected, I think is important. And I'll talk about a little bit more about that in a moment. So, you know, these three defining features, educated, diverse, and connected is I think how you easily kind of capture these two generations together and perhaps what differentiates them from earlier generations in the country. Now, if we go ahead to the next slide and we ask, okay, what makes them different? Well, all the research that I've done says, you know, how we were raised, and I say we, because I'm part of it, was different. We saw the rise of the self-esteem movement. We saw, you know, if the generation being the first, my generation to being first, you know, in school from a very young age, junior kindergarten, senior kindergarten. And so being institutionalized, having kind of people always around us, giving us feedback, telling how we were doing, has produced an outlook that requires a lot of, you know, structure and a lot of feedback. And we hear that particularly in the workplace in terms of how to lead millennials and how millennials lead now. Increasingly, they are leading. The other point to keep in mind about particularly millennials, as I said, I'm 40. I'm no kid anymore. And so, you know, especially the older sub cohort of millennials, they're not, you know, they're parents themselves. They're mid-career. They're thinking about retirement and how to buy a home or how to upgrade their home if they're seeking to own it. And so always remembering that is important. But beyond just how we were raised, you can't talk about these two generations and not talk about technology. And I'm not even going to kind of go deep here because I think it's pretty obvious. But this is generations that were the first digital natives. They grew up with, whether it was my generation having, you know, video games and cable TV, and then now merging into mobile devices and being constantly connected and having an on-demand presence means that the way we get information, the way we connect with others, the way we learn and ultimately make decisions is very different to how my parents' generations, you know, came of age and understand that. And despite how connected we are, I think it's always remember important to remember just how isolated we can also become. I think that's true of society generally. We curate the information that we consume. We pick the organizations and friends and others that we follow, whether that on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or TikTok or Snapchat, for those platforms that I have no idea how they work, but they're incredibly popular among younger generations. That means we can't assume that information is getting down to them in terms of how do you reach them. So that's a quick overview of these two generations. Now, so how are they feeling? And as I said, on the next slide, we've been tracking, attitudes among these two generations for many years now. And just as a surface point, and I think it's important always to start with like the psyche of how folks are feeling. On the next slide, we always ask that famous pollster question, do you think the country's headed in the right direction or is it headed on the wrong track? And you can see the evolution since early January 2018, the first time we did this survey. And over the course of, 2018 and then into 2019, that right direction number was headed downwards. In fact, if you look at the general population in Canada, that was true. People were less satisfied with the federal government's performance. Things didn't seem to be going all that well. And in a weird, perverse way, once the pandemic started, we almost saw the reverse happen. We saw people starting to feel, maybe the country's moving in the right direction. Certain things are having a positive effect. We ended our last survey in June of 2021 with, almost back to where we started in this tracking, 52% having a positive view. And that was, I think, driven largely by the vaccination efforts in the sense in June, which no longer really, I think, is the sense of the country that perhaps we were getting out of this pandemic in short order. Similarly, if we go to the next slide and we ask people, are you generally optimistic about Canada's future or are you generally worried? You can see that more say they're optimistic than pessimistic. Now, obviously, this is the national numbers. If you ask young people in Alberta, they feel very differently than people say in Quebec or Ontario, where the economic and social situations are very different. If you ask those from lower income backgrounds or from rural Canada, again, different perspectives. This is the national number and you get to see the trend, but we see some pretty different numbers going forward. On the next slide, I've just plotted the negative perceptions. And you do see once the pandemic starts, a real rise in pessimism around, the state of the economy, which has improved in recent months. But we know that younger Canadians were most, or at least as impacted negatively by the pandemic. Many of them work in retail, food service, hospitality. And so particularly young women. And so the pandemic has had this kind of freezing effect on many of their lives, particularly younger millennials who may have, just about to start post-secondary and Gen Z, I should say, or those that were looking to, advance their career, a whole bunch of things this pandemic has really had an effect on. And we don't really, I'm not one to predict what it means going forward, but it's certainly going to have an effect. Now, when you ask them on the next slide, what are the top priorities for the federal government? I'm just looking at federal issues right now, but you can extrapolate these to issues, at the provincial or municipal level. And, what we see is that as top issues, housing, improving the healthcare system, creating good jobs, reducing personal income taxes, these are all key priorities for young Canadians right now, housing in particular. And I think we'll talk a lot about housing in our panel discussion. If you go down the list on the next slide and you look at what's at the bottom, reforming the electoral system. If you go to the next slide for a moment, not that important to young people, legalizing and regulating cannabis, helping the energy sector in Alberta succeed. Go to the next slide. We ask folks, how are you feeling about, your standard of living? What we find is that most young people say they're either living within their means, but paycheck to paycheck, or, a sizable minority say they're living beyond their means. Now, these two worlds, those who are living comfortably and those who are not, I think is reflected in the broader population. But it's also, it's important to keep in mind just how challenged many young people are feeling in terms of being able to achieve the kind of lifestyle that they want to achieve. Lastly, their ability to purchase a home has become, I think, a critical question if we go to the next slide. And when we asked young people in June, You know, which of the following best describes how you're feeling about the possibility of buying a home? And this is among people who don't currently own a home, which is most young people, I should say, in Canada right now. You can see that a third say they've either given up or they're pretty pessimistic. And another third say, I'm optimistic still, but becoming more worried, right? 70% of young people who don't currently own their home definitely want to buy a home. They see it as part of their life objectives and goals. One of the top five, most of them will put there. And so the sense that in most markets now, not just in big cities, but across the country, that housing is not something they can achieve is a source of challenge for them. Moving ahead, beyond specific priorities, I want to just share some really interesting data on what they think about some big issues. So for example, on the next slide, how do they feel about the role of government? Is government almost always wasteful and efficient, or is government, you know, does it provide good services that help make life better and more affordable? First of all, I compared younger folks with that red bar, which is those over the age of 42. You see not much difference, right? Younger folks a little more likely to say, yeah, you know, government provides good services, but there's a whole lot of skeptics about government among younger people. And that's important. And we'll come back to that in a minute. On the next slide, we asked this question, you know, when you look at the changes in the economy, do you typically look at it as threats to your quality of life, or are they opportunities to improve it? Again, not a whole lot of difference. Lots of young people, as there are older Canadians, who feel threatened by the change that's happening. Oftentimes people say, oh, you know, young people are ready to ride this wave of change. Well, some are and feel confident about it, but more are feeling threatened by the, you know, the immense change that's happening. And so always remember, especially as conservatives, about how you can speak to that and offer solutions that make people feel confident about their future. Next slide, please. I think you're gonna like this one. When we ask folks, you know, do you think government regulation of business is necessary to protect the public interest, or do you think government regulation of business usually does more harm than good? And if I think it's the next slide, please. Again, younger people more likely to think, less likely to think that government regulation is good. Now, most people do, and that's something for us to talk about as a side note, but note the skepticism that's more apparent among younger people than it is among older ones. That's not something you might think about, but when you talk about regulating the internet, when you talk about regulating different other sectors, you know, Airbnb, shared service, young people could point to a lot of things, services that they use, the government has kind of gotten in the way of innovation and opportunity. And I think there's an opportunity there for conservatives to talk about that. Next slide. What about taxing the rich? Lots of talk about that during the last federal election. If I told you that young people were the least likely to say that the rich in Canada don't pay enough taxes, you'd say, David, I don't believe you, but that's the case, right? 86% of those over 42 think the rich don't pay enough, compared to 61 among 18 to 29 year olds, right? So again, not, still the majority view, but there's opportunities here. I know we're gonna talk about branding on our panel today. And a few years ago, Dennis Mathew, a friend of mine who worked for Prime Minister Harper and Kate Harrison, we did some branding work on the Conservative Party, and I'll say that. And so on the next slide, we asked Canadians, and we asked, this is their responses among younger Canadians, give me a word to describe the Liberal Party and the Conservative Party. And you can see that both of them have their problems, right? There's like these are not brands, like if you were Coke or, you know, Toyota, you would hate to see some of this. But I think if you look at what particularly young people think about conservative, and now this is the Conservative Party, but I think it extends beyond that, what the biggest words are the ones they use the most often. So old, you know, I think stands out as something that's particularly challenging, especially in trying to connect with younger audiences. Now on the Liberal side, you know, they have open as their biggest word. But they also have lots of corrupt and untrustworthy and liars. So they've got their own challenges. But on the next slide, we did an interesting exercise. We showed a whole bunch of pictures to respondents, and we said, which of these do you think best describes the Conservative Party right now? And you can see here, you've got the stock exchange, a family, and oil, right? An oil derrick. Those are the ones that were most likely identified. And not all of these, like some of these are positive, family, right? Connection, business, but the oil one, I think is an interesting one. As we know that climate change becomes more important to people, that if you're associated with that industry, that potentially is a problem. Last slide, when we asked about the Liberals, what image best described the Liberals? Well, you see, you know, young people, you see someone, a young boy carrying a Canadian flag. And then if you can read that shirt, it basically says, you know, no homophobia, no violence, no racism, no sexism, and so on. And so the Liberal brand is very much connected to equality and diversity, and the Conservative one to family, energy sector, and business. And I'm just going to end there, because I think our panel's got lots to say about it. But I think the question of brand is an important one, because you can align on all the issues. You can have great policies that help young people understand how they're going to buy a home or how they're going to get a good job, or even good climate policies that are conservative oriented. At the end of the day, if they don't think that you care about their issues, if you're not relevant, it's going to be harder to connect with this audience. So I'm going to stop there, because I know Ginny and Kieran and Landon, we all have lots to talk about, and I'll hand it back to you.
We do. Thanks, David. We can start right there on brand. I think that's a good conversation for us to jump into. So I want to bring Kieran in here to ask the first question on the conservative brand right now here in Canada and any sort of stigmas that are associated with it. You know, what can leaders and organizational leaders be thinking about to maybe reshift and revitalize some of the conservative brand pieces that David had pointed out there?
Absolutely. Thanks, David. That was really, really interesting. And I think you did a lot of the heavy lifting for us today, so much appreciated. I think the current sort of state of the Conservative Party is mostly a brand and a false narrative issue. I do believe that if the federal election was a blind vote where Gen Z and millennials were just presented policy and didn't see any leaders or any other, qualitative information, then we would do quite well as conservatives, which probably bodes for us well in the future. It's just about how do we kind of change that perception so that we can actually win those voters who are reasonably well aligned with policy. And I think the problem stems from Gen Z and millennials' basically shallow and wide understanding of politics right now. Just spending 7-8 hours of the day on social media, they have a very shallow and wide kind of information base. There's such a wealth of information, but we live in this age where the power of the individual has become so strong to craft narratives. And in that shallow and wide ecosystem, it's quite easy for them to sort of be tripped up on a false narrative. I think we saw this frequently during the federal election and also during any kind of news cycle in the US surrounding Republicans. For example, when Texas sort of began this abortion ban, there was a ton of commentary from Gen Zs across TikTok and Instagram about how the conservatives would also be implementing kind of similar archaic laws surrounding women's reproductive rights. And it's truly false narratives, of course, but the power of those individuals to craft those narratives is really strong. And as I mentioned, when the understanding of policy and brand is very shallow and wide, it's easy for those perceptions to be changed. So the opportunity was really just to shift that perception, to spend some time actually debunking some of those false narratives, kind of choosing your battles, but also just to spend some time on those platforms, which those Gen Z and millennials are consuming that information and questioning kind of how can we actually present information in a way which is engaging and relatable, so that instead of them consuming information from an individual, they're actually consuming it from trusted sources. Because a lot of those sort of content pieces which they're consuming right now are often created by individuals, like I suggested, versus trusted sources to some degree. So that's another issue which I guess everyone needs to spend a bit of time on, just to be debunking false information and choosing your battle in that regard. I'm happy to touch more on, I guess, the pillars and building a strong brand to change that perception. And I think we might get to that a little bit later as well. So I'll stop there for now.
Yeah, I want to touch base with Ginny quick and get her temperature on if Kieran's on the right track or not, or has he sort of missed any pieces as we're thinking about a brand shift or revitalization?
And brand is important, and I like that Kieran used the word narrative. I think in some ways that's even more important. You know, there's broad-based brand impressions, but in a given election, the goal of the conservative movement is for its party, its like biggest party that represents its people, to form power and govern the country. You need a winning campaign narrative that when people go to vote, they are swayed by the conservative party for whatever reason, regardless of their view of the brand. And I think you see how more or less important that is based on whether the Conservatives are in power or not. When Stephen Harper had a majority government, it's not like people thought the Conservatives had this brand that was, you know, deeply compelling to young people. I don't think people anecdotally thought that was true. But the Conservatives didn't care because he was prime minister, right? And so, but what he did have was a narrative that won him enough votes in a parliamentary democracy to win enough seats to form government. So I would discipline us a bit away from brand, because the proposition for a political movement isn't to win over consumers, it's to win over voters, and that's, I think, a fundamentally different exercise. But narrative still matters, and we know that voters do not read party platforms. Like, that's just not something that the vast majority of voters do. They consume media passively, usually. And then, you know, they maybe make a choice to vote. In many cases, people don't even vote at all. And so when it comes down to that question, yeah, obviously the Conservatives have a lot of work to do. My thesis today, and I won't belabor it too much because I'm sure I'll come back to it through different questions. My thesis is sort of, we should be concerned as Conservatives about what our narrative says to people and why voters opt not to choose our path, particularly when you would think that they're, for young people, as David pointed out, their biases might actually line up pretty well with a sort of ideological spectrum of conservative thought. We get really concerned about that, but I think I worry sometimes that we overcorrect and we look at, okay, where do we underperform? Well, we always underperform with women. We underperform with young people. And so we think, how do we become less threatening to those people? And then we sort of water down our proposition, our narrative, to the point of not saying anything, really, much of anything to anyone. And I don't think that's a winning proposition. And so I'm much more interested in talking about how can we drive a narrative that's a contrast narrative that stands apart from our political opponents on some of these issues where we know we have the strongest answer, particularly if we lean into it aggressively. So I think housing is a really, really good example, and I hope we'll get into that. How can we craft a narrative that drives a really tough choice for some of these young people and get, frankly, more bullish about saying, if you are a 32-year-old woman of color with a baby living in Richmond Hill, there are a million reasons why you should vote conservative, and the party should, I think, and the movement should get serious about thinking through where the Venn diagram of those interests overlap with our ideological biases, and where we can drive a contrast narrative that says that, you know, the conservative party is a party for you.
An excellent point. And Ginny, I feel like right-of-center organizations, political parties are talking about these issues that David highlighted, housing, affordability, jobs, especially in the perspective of young people and new young Canadians. So is it a perception challenge that we're having communicating our policy to these communities, or is it something deeper that's maybe the reason as to why we're not able to connect with some of those younger crowds so effectively?
I think it's deeper than that. I think, you know, if you, I don't know, you know, David did some exit polling, I'm curious to hear more about what it said, but I think if you asked a voter, and it's, let's say, a millennial voter in a swing riding, right, that theoretically should vote conservative, what they thought of our housing policy, I'm not sure they could tell you what our housing policy was or why it would help them afford a home, right? They certainly, what policy, like, what are you talking about? Whereas if the party and the movement had been able to reach that person on a platform where they consume media and in a way and through a message that sort of said, you know, there aren't enough homes in the place that you live, and more of them need to be built in order for you to afford it, and here's how we're going to get that done. I'm not crafting the party's message on the back of a napkin right now, but you can imagine how that would drive a much starker choice for someone. And I think when you try to have a political platform that tries to be all things to all people, that can be tougher. And so perception is part of it, yes, but I think a stark choice on the issues that matter to young people is kind of the way to think about it. And picking issues where you don't need to win 60% of the population, but if you win 40% of the population in ridings that matter, with people who we know vote, and that's the reason you can't write off young people, right? I mean, when you look at David's slide on the growth of the millennial and Gen Z population, there's just an inevitability, not that we need to appeal to young people, but that we need to appeal to enough people. And that's the way the population's getting, those generations are getting older and taking up more space in our population. So we have to appeal to them. And we need to present, I think, a starker choice for those people that appeal to them on the issues they care about.
And if I could just add to that, mm-hmm. You know, I think it has to go beyond, frankly, tax credits. Like, tax credits alone don't tell me you care about issues that I care about, right? I think, to Ginny's point, housing is an example, climate change. You've got to talk a lot about these issues in order to get people to see you as a party that cares about them, right? It's one thing to have a platform, but it's another thing for them to say, I think you're going to do the best job on it. And I think, you know, the Conservatives in the last campaign, I think Ginny's right, very few people, anyone, frankly, could name exactly what the Conservative platform was on housing. But I think they've clearly competed with the other parties to say we have a platform and we care about it because you had the leader out there talking a lot about it. And that, mm-hmm. to me, is what's really important. And sometimes Conservative leaders don't talk enough about the issues they care about, even if you have different solutions to getting the problem solved. If you don't talk about it, then no one thinks you care about it. And that, to me, is that deeper problem that I think Conservatives sometimes have with the issues that voters generally, but in particular young voters, care about.
Definitely. Thanks for adding that there. I want to flip back to something that's on my mind. Ginny, you had said, you know, being things to all people and going in that direction, but there are some people that I wonder if we can start going after, and I want to bring Kieran in onto this as it's something I think him and I have heard from a lot of young people, and that's that we're you know, socially liberal and fiscally conservative, yet maybe that's not translating at the ballot box, or that's not translating into getting involved in advocacy organizations and other things that the right movement is trying to do. So I want to start with Kieran by figuring out, is there any ground to gain with those folks in particular that, like myself, will openly say, you know, I'm socially liberal but fiscally conservative, and starting to win that conversation with those people?
I absolutely think there's meaningful ground to gain there. As we all know, Gen Z and young millennials matured during the 2008 recession, so they saw the firsthand consequences of basically financial insecurity on their families, mm-hmm. and now they have a lot of financial anxiety as a result. Interestingly, Gen Z differs a little bit from millennials in that they're slightly more pragmatic. So when you look at the data of post-secondary graduates amongst millennials, you see a lot of kind of general arts graduates, whereas about 70% of Gen Z students in the post-secondary segment intend on graduating with a business degree, a comp sci degree, an engineering, or a general science degree. So they're trying to find education which will enable them to actually become employed very shortly after schooling. They're also saving at a much earlier age. I actually have a data point in front of me for some research that we did with some of the Canadian banks, and about 90% of Gen Zs and young millennials under the age of 25 opened and deposited money in a savings account before they turned 20, which is kind of a stark difference from later stage millennials and older demographics as well. And 25% of Gen Zs and millennials under the age of 30 have investment accounts as well. It's unclear how much money is in those investment accounts, but they're working hard to get education, which will gain them employment. They are working hard to save money and invest early on, and they're very concerned about their finances. So I think there's a great conversation to be had with those people about how conservative policy can help them get there. A lot of those people are learning about compounding now, and if they can, for example, see that by paying slightly less tax, they're going to end up with, and for example, setting aside a couple thousand dollars each year, they're going to end up with hundreds of thousands of dollars more since they're saving so young, mm-hmm. then those are meaningful kind of data points and conversations to be had. But I think the challenge is you can only win over those voters if you don't give them a reason to walk away. As much as these young voters have financial anxiety, if they don't believe that the Conservatives are going to take action on climate change or other social issues, then those will be the reasons they walk away, despite them knowing that they might be able to shelve some more money and retire younger under a Conservative government, perhaps. So you have to balance that with the other key issues, which they are really voting on. And ultimately, which we've seen a lot of false narratives, again, surrounding the Conservatives, which have, in many cases, given them that reason to walk away. So be pragmatic, be honest, acknowledge that hardship and that anxiety that they currently face, but mm-hmm. do your best to show how the Conservatives can kind of paint a better future for them. And also just do your best to actually add value to these people who are actively seeking out resources on financial literacy and information on how to save, how to invest, et cetera. I think there's a bit of a gap there in terms of the education need and desire and what's currently being done. If it's all policy related, wonderful, but ultimately they need to actually educate themselves and figure out how they can kind of paint a better future for themselves.
Definitely. Ginny, I saw you nodding along there at a few points. So is there some intersection here between the millennials and Gen Zs that are openly saying we're socially liberal, fiscally conservative, but not, you know, this whole being too many things to old people?
Yeah, I might argue a bit with some points that Kieran made. So I think I wrote a National Post column that quoted that exact line, that sort of like I'm socially liberal but fiscally conservative line that people use. I'm a conservative who grew up in central Toronto, so I'm used to being the person that, you know, I'll say at a cocktail party that I'm a conservative. And people will, you know, after they get over their shock, they'll sort of say, oh, right, okay, but you mean a fiscal conservative, like you're not, you're socially liberal. And then I have to sort of, I decide whether I bite my tongue and say, no, I'm just a conservative. I don't need a qualifier. So I know a lot of people who describe themselves that way who would never vote conservative. Or even if they would, they live in a riding that frankly the Conservatives will very, very unlikely to win. Mm. And so I just don't want to be distracted. I think if you're talking about how the conservative movement can be successful in political campaigns, I wouldn't want to be distracted by people who insist that they're fiscal conservatives, but ultimately matters of social justice or climate change or other issues are going to always be their vote driver. And I think when you look at the broad range of conservative issues, those aren't going to be our areas of focus. And if they are, I think those voters are going to choose the real deal. They're going to choose the party that they believe is associated with social justice. And I don't think that's ever going to be the Conservatives in Canada. That's not to say that there aren't millennials and Gen Z voters in ridings that could help the Conservatives form government who, yes, care about you know, their ability to pay the bills, who care about their ability to form a home, and who, if we take certain issues off the table that freak them out about conservatives, may consider voting for us. Those, I think, are the voters that the conservative movement should care about and try to appeal to. And so I think that's why it's worth making sure some of those false narratives, as Kieran pointed out, don't stand up and don't pass muster. Like, I think particularly issues around, like, racial equality and gender equality and some of the core things that I think fundamentally conservatives believe in, fundamental freedoms, they believe in fairness, they believe in all sorts of things that make those false narratives untrue. But I would focus on that. I would focus on those sort of core conservative principles and then stand up policy solutions that really deliver in a concrete way for voters instead of trying to appeal on grounds that I think the voters that are motivated on them, like let's say social justice issues, for example, I just don't think that conservatives win on when those are that's driving the ballot box question.
Awesome points. David, I'm also seeing you nod along a little bit at some points in this discussion. If we start to adopt some of the things that Ginny and Kieran are saying here, do you think we might start seeing different words come up when people are describing conservatives, particularly Gen Zs and millennials?
I think you can. I think, you know, that big old word, I think, to me says just, I don't feel you're relevant right now, right? And that relevance is what I think is important. It's not it's not going to where voters are, but bringing them to where you are, but making it relevant in the current context of their lives. And I think to both Kieran and Ginny's points, right? And I didn't get to show you this slide in my presentation, but as of June, before the election, 40% of those under the age of 40 said they'd be open to voting conservative, right? Now that's not tiny. That's a lot of young people still saying open to it. Now, if you compare it to the Liberals at the time, it was 62%. So you're 20 points back. But if you start again, and I agree with Ginny 100%, there is no way if a voter says the number one issue is climate change that they may ever vote for the conservative party or a conservative party at the provincial level. But to Kieran's point, there are many voters who will say housing is my number one issue. And I might vote for the party I think is best on it, but I just can't get over the fact that the conservatives don't seem to care enough about it, right? Like it's a disqualifier, but it's not the conversion. And so I think that's the road to getting a slightly larger tent, right? Without saying our principles aren't important or that we shouldn't stand firmly for what we believe. Because frankly, I look at politics today as somebody who observes this closely and looks at how Canadians react to it. They look at our political leaders generally and say, none of these people actually stand for anything. And you have the Prime Minister of Canada going on vacation the day of our first national truth and reconciliation. Like that to me is like a proof point to young people that like this guy doesn't even care about what he says. So, they want you to stand on what you believe, but they also need to know that you recognize, I think that times do change and that your party is changing with them, but it doesn't mean your core principles have to. And so that's my take on how to, navigate this audience, but know that there's evidence that they will vote for conservative ideas, and they will vote for them when they feel comfortable that, not only will you do what you say you're going to do, and this is the other side of it, but that if they were to tell somebody else they did that, right? Mm-hmm. That the reaction that maybe Ginny gets at those parties in downtown Toronto wouldn't happen as often. And so you need to give them a little bit of cover that they can defend that choice.
Definitely. As you were talking, I was thinking in my head about how, we can share good ideas and we can try to move past things that have happened in the past for political leaders, but often that path of recovery with voters and young people can be a little bit more challenging. If particularly conservatives have stumbled before, the path to rebuilding that trust with a young voter doesn't seem to be as easy as it is for, say, big brands and big companies that will have a scandal or will have a setback or will step outside of something that doesn't reflect their values. But, consumers will bounce back if they can see that that brand is trying to rebuild trust with their community, trying to rebuild trust with their employees, et cetera. But it seems like if we cross into the political world, conservatives have a tough time doing that, especially once we've stumbled. So, Kieran, I'm wondering if maybe you can shed some light on if there's any lessons from the private sector, from sort of the private brand space that can be shared and thought about in the conservative world.
Yeah, absolutely. I really think it's about consistency in sharing the party's values and controlling the narrative, but also changing the brand perception to some degree. The way I think about this is that if the narrative is unclear, if the values are unclear, or if there's not a strong brand, then when a politician makes a slip up, instead of that being a exception to the rule, they'll see it as sort of that individual revealing their true colors. Yeah. So for example, if Trudeau makes a mistake, then they'll say, oh, well, that's an exception to the rule, because they'll kind of brand themselves in what they perceive the Liberal Party identity to be. In contrast, if O'Toole makes a mistake, then they'll say, oh, look, O'Toole's revealing his true colors. And I think that became clear when he made just a tiny slip up regarding residential schools. And that became a huge, huge talking point for several weeks across social. And he spent some time kind of doing social listening on TikTok and Instagram. It was quite popular amongst young voters as well, which is quite unfortunate. So I think you have to ground yourself in those values. And the way you do that is just having a consistent kind of narrative and a consistent voice on both the federal, provincial, and municipal level. I do believe that's one of the challenges right now is there's a bit of a gap between some of the social conservatives in the party and some of the small C conservatives in the party, where the ideology and values might be slightly different. And perhaps that gap between leaders is slightly different than gaps between leaders in other parties. And as a result, there's a bit of inconsistency, which kind of clutters the or makes it unclear what the party really stands for. So that when there's a slip up, again, it's hard to ground yourself in what voters or what the general population of Canada knows to be true about the party.
Yeah.
And that's when you have that kind of revealing true colors problem versus people just accepting that as a mistake and moving on. So I think just being clear on values, establishing that consistency on all three levels of government, and ultimately just acknowledging the mistake and correcting, overcorrecting very quickly is also the best way to go about that. People that don't acknowledge the mistake and brands that don't acknowledge their mistakes quickly are often the ones that suffer the most. So acknowledge quickly, apologize, and overcorrect. And ultimately that strong brand or strong kind of narrative, to Ginny's point, is a good thing to sort of ground yourself in when those challenges arise.
Right on. Well, you make it sound easy. Ginny, is it that easy that Kieran's saying we can, you know, apologize, move on, and begin to rebuild that trust in some of the way that the private sector does?
I think it depends where you're coming from. Like, I think it's easy when you have authenticity and sort of strength of, you know, a strong core and a strong set of principles and a strong leader that is sort of brave, frankly, and staking out grounds and then sticking to it. I think sometimes as conservatives, for good reason, I mean, when you're not in government or when you're struggling as a movement to win power and win over a bigger tent of support, it can be tempting to, on every single issue, think about and script out the least offensive possible position, right? And then you know, memorize the talking point, say the talking point, and then hopefully you don't slip up. And the problem with that is it's not, there's no true north to come back to because it doesn't represent a core set of values of a person or a movement. And so because it's scripted, it's hard to kind of on the spot when you're in a debate context or, you know, for example, or something like that, there isn't that core true north to come back to because if something goes off script, all you have is the script. And that's why authentic leaders that have been popular in this sort of decade or so of populist government, in some ways they seem like they're Teflon, right? And I think this is true, by the way, of Justin Trudeau a little bit. He does sound scripted sometimes, but I think ultimately he has a populist authenticity that allows him to have a bit of a Teflon to him because he feels so strongly about his own personal principles and where he comes from and how he views things, that if he slips up, it's not really a slip up. It's just, it's who he is, and people kind of bake that in. And so it's hard. I mean, the practical challenge for a movement where you've got leaders at multiple levels of government, and maybe you're cycling through leaders if you're losing elections, that makes this all the more challenging because voters get confused. It's sort of like, what do you stand for? Where are you coming from? And I think leadership is so important. And this is not a comment on any current leader, by the way, at any level of government. It's just true, I think, for all political parties. Leaderships are so important because you're ultimately choosing someone who is going to respond to unpredictable events and have a narrative and a brand and a view of the world that when challenged won't falter. And that builds trust in people because they start to be able to predict what you're like and they start to have a sense of who you are and what your party stands for. And it becomes less about, can you convince people that you stand for certain things, because you just do. And so when you respond to something that happens in the media or a world event, it comes from a sense of voters knowing who you are and what your party stands for. And so I don't know, there's no easy solution for that, for capturing that authenticity. But I think young people especially are looking for that. I'm not sure if the data or the research bears that out, but certainly my anecdotal observation of politics would. And it also makes strategizing around these things easier because the strategy becomes, well, what does the leadership believe is the best path? And hopefully that aligns with what voters want, and then delivering in an election context on driving a concrete view of that narrative for voters that they can understand and that they can see, you know, helping them in their lives.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. And on the note of narrative and sort of communicating authenticity, I want to shift gears a little bit and talk about engagement mediums. when it comes to the right of center, when it comes to conservative organizations, I wonder if we're engaging with Gen Z and millennials in the most effective way that we can. As a young person myself, I'm not sure I can say that we do, but I wonder if this panel has some perspective on, you know, what are the right social mediums to be engaging with young people, and especially as I think about what you've said, Ginny, on authenticity. You know, once we've identified those mediums, can we engage with these young people in an authentic way through those mediums?
I guess I can jump in quickly and kick it off. I think we have to. And you know, kudos to the two conservatives in the movement who are trying to help the movement go a bit more digital, where we know whether it's Gen Z on TikTok or my generation, I'm a middle millennial and I just had a baby. So I've spent an inordinate amount of time on Instagram with like the mommy blogger, mommy Instagram world and the sort of Facebook. And then, you know, my neighborhood Facebook, you know, street party group, like those are the two places that I live, which is very different from the Gen Z on TikTok. But either way, that's where my peers are. And where they're being reached. I mean, the number of people who've cut the cord who are, you know, under 40, I'm sure is extraordinarily high. Mm-hmm. So reaching them through traditional broadcast media is a mistake, or trying to. Mm-hmm. And you know, the conservative movement, to their credit, the political parties have broadly done what other big political parties have done, which is shift ad buy spending away from broadcast and towards digital. But I think there's always more work to be done, right? Like the federal Liberal Party, if you look at, if you read some of the articles on there, it's their own spin. So whether you believe it or not is a different story, but they tell us a compelling story about how they took their political platform, which we earlier talked about, people don't actually read the political platforms, and they turned it into literally thousands of different iterations of hyper-targeted Facebook advertising or digital advertising, I think mainly Facebook. The algorithm's making that a bit harder to have get as much bang for your buck, but it's still much, much more impactful. And so I think our movement's actually pretty good on that front, and we're on the right media, but making sure it's the right content and the right message, I think is key. And we need to keep being at the forefront of that, because it's changing faster than the election cycles happen. And so I'm encouraged. Like I could easily picture us on the stage, being on the stage and saying the conservatives are doing a horrible job and we're not reaching people where they are. We're doing better than you might expect for a party that tends to be a bit more backward looking in our sort of ideological view, but we could do better. And making sure the content is the right content is, you know, applies to our earlier conversation and is, I think, in some ways more relevant.
I absolutely agree with Ginny. I think it's really a question of how, to some degree, not what platforms, but how we're engaging people on those platforms. The tonality of Instagram versus TikTok versus Twitter versus LinkedIn is just so, so different. I thought O'Toole actually did a really wonderful job throughout the election on LinkedIn, as well as Instagram was incredibly active. But you just have to consider the tonality of those platforms. You can't take the same message that you would share on LinkedIn and bring that to TikTok, because people will absolutely just laugh at you and it won't be received very positively. And I'm not saying you have to go quite as far as Jagmeet and some of the other party leaders in the NDP doing a lot of dancing TikToks and things there, which are honestly received surprisingly well, though not by everybody. But you do have to consider the tone in which you're engaging people and how people are actually interacting with others on the platform. You can't just share the same message across everywhere, because the demographics of people change as you go from platform to platform, as does the actual means of engagement. And I think to our sort of prior discussion on recovering from mistakes, those different platforms present the opportunity to actually show a glimpse into your life beyond the politician. And in this day and age, young, I guess, Gen Z voters, as well as young millennial voters, almost find it a bit suspicious if you only see the person's kind of professional image online, where this social environment's presented everybody with the opportunity to actually show what they stand for on a personal level. So, I mean, to the NDP's, I guess, point, that kind of content, which is fun and human on TikTok and other platforms, actually gives people a bit of kind of shows people some sense of humanity that they might not otherwise get from other leaders. And I think that interaction actually enables people to recover from mistakes a little bit faster as well, because they'll say, oh no, he seems like a pretty decent guy. It's obviously not a replacement from actually interacting them in person, which is the real ideal situation. Because I mean, in most cases, if you have a party leader knock on your door and you have a conversation, you think, oh wow, this is actually a much better person than I might have previously thought. There's actually a lot of common ground between us two. And social provides that opportunity at scale. So it's just about understanding the tone of the platforms and engaging people in a smart way.
Awesome. I think that makes sense. I just want to check in with David and see if that makes sense from a data perspective. You know, you had shared a few platforms that are common mediums for younger people. So were some of these things being said lining up with your perspectives there?
Yeah, I think, you know, just to keep in mind, more Canadians under 40 say they check some, they watch something on YouTube, like 65 than anything else. And YouTube, I think, particularly among even younger cohorts, is like the place where it all starts. It's where you get your content, whatever that content might be. And you could, like, I have conversations with my like 19-year-old nephew, cousin, I'm not that old, where like he literally spends all night like just looking for content on YouTube and can like, you know, find it. So there's ways of, you know, definitely these platforms are all unique and they're different. I think the point about tone, I think is really important. And I can't help but think the challenge with social media though is that you're speaking to multiple audiences on the same platform, right? And so content that you would use to engage and mobilize your core supporters, right? If I just think of like, and we're using the Conservative Party here as like an example, but you know, the things that they might tweet, that the party might tweet, might be super engaging for conservatives, and like it's the red meat, like Trudeau's a you know, an idiot, and he's doing these stupid things. Whereas for people who might want to engage with the conservatives, they can still see that content, and so you have to. It's really hard, I imagine, to manage a social platform where your audiences are so diverse and they're looking for very different things. And so I think tone is important in thinking about, you know, what some of that content might mean for somebody who's not as engaged. Now, do I think millions of young people are following the Conservative Party Twitter account? No. And so it's not as risky, but that content gets shared and that becomes the thing they remember. So there's risk too in being overexposed on social, because that stuff doesn't easily go away, and people remember, that's the only thing they remember you about. To Kieran's point, it's hard to sometimes come back from that. So no, but most of what I think my colleagues here said makes sense based on what the data that I'm seeing.
Landon, if you don't mind, I'll just add one more thing that David made me think about, which is that I think social media is a real gift for conservatives, because I don't think it's like a conspiracy theory to believe that the mainstream media is not historically friendly to conservatives. Like, that is just a fact. And I don't, by the way, I'm not a proponent of, well, we should just shut them out. I think having a strong relationship to the mainstream media, I think the movement creating new media outlets that are right of center and friendly to conservatives, all that's really important and really good. But social media allows conservatives to bypass the gatekeepers a little bit. And that, I think, can be really, really powerful and beneficial to conservatives who are trying to appeal to voters who, you know, previously you would have had to make your way through gatekeepers and your message would have been mediated through editors and producers and others who may well have a baked-in bias, frankly, against conservatives. And so if you can bypass that and go straight to voters through social media channels, I think that could be really powerful. And in some ways, it's a tool that conservatives are more likely to use than progressives, because I think progressives sometimes rely on that mainstream media a little bit more. And conservatives previously would have been locked out of being able to tell their story directly to voters. So I think that's a good thing. And that, for me, that's why we can't take social media off the table and why we probably need to lean into it even more.
Definitely. I love that note about leaning into it more, and doing it with the right tone is totally the way to go, both from a political perspective, but also for sort of the right of center organizations that are trying to connect with young people and build bases across the country. I want to shift gears a little bit as we look to wrap up this discussion. I would remind our audience that we have an opportunity to ask some questions as well. But when we think about engaging with specific groups of millennials or Gen Zs within those two demographics. I wonder if there's an easy win for us here. You know, Kieran and I, we both came from the startup space, a space that he's still in, and a space that I think a lot of Gen Zs and millennials will continue to go into. A space where it's maybe smaller teams, more digital work environments, and Canada being a place for entrepreneurship. But yet, as I reflect on some of my conversations with other young entrepreneurs, I was a bit surprised that maybe conservative organizations and the conservative movement maybe didn't come as a natural home to many young entrepreneurs in Canada. Not that to say that they had another home, but they just were a little bit unfamiliar with where their political home was. So I want to ask our colleagues here, you know, are young entrepreneurs a vehicle for us to connect and engage meaningfully with millennials and Gen Zs here in Canada? Kieran, I'm wondering if maybe that's something you want to jump on.
I'd love to, yeah. I actually, I'm cheating a bit because I have a couple data points surrounding young Gen Zs and millennials from some research we did on side hustles amongst these cohorts. Mm-hmm. So over 50% of Gen Zs and young millennials, so we're looking at people between the ages of 16 to 26, have reported making income from some means of self-employment. So this is really the side hustle generation. A lot of that entrepreneurship is driven by financial anxiety, but also, again, as the result of maturing during the financial recession, and now COVID has been another catalyst during to this, where they're seeing that those traditionally stable jobs are maybe not quite as stable as they once thought or as previous generations thought. So they're questioning, how can we actually find ways to diversify income, generate a little bit more money, especially autonomously? I mean, there's lots of ways to set up e-commerce stores, et cetera, which they're leaning into, which present opportunities to have passive income while they actually have another job. So I do think there's a great opportunity to almost become the entrepreneurship party to some degree. I don't think any party is necessarily doing drastically better than the other in this regard, but it's clear that a significant majority of the people within this demographic intend on having some income from a means of self-employment. So I do think that's a meaningful opportunity. I think it's just about providing them with the necessary kind of resources to actually get started. In starting a few businesses, I was very fortunate because I had some people in my network which had kind of gone through that gauntlet, but it is super daunting. I assume that, there's a bit of a gap between the people which have said they desire to start a business and they actually have started a business or have some means of self-employment income right now. And I think that gap is really just the daunting task of getting started. How do you incorporate, for example, a business? How do you get a business bank account? There's a lot of simple questions which need to be answered. And I think there's an opportunity for a committee within a party, for example, to really lead that and just support those young entrepreneurs to help them find other passive means of income or even just start their business and make that a full-time opportunity. So obviously, policy is something I'll let kind of Ginny and David touch on. But I do think from a resource standpoint, there's a meaningful opportunity just to help them kind of get started.
Yeah. I think this sort of bucket of issues is totally low-hanging fruit for the conservatives. It's not the kind of thing where, you know, if there's an election in 18 months, it's going to, the election's going to hang on it, right? Because there just isn't enough well-developed policy in that space, frankly, from any political party. The Liberals tried a bit, and I think, frankly, like the jury's out. I don't think people vote for the Liberals because they're strong on entrepreneurship and innovation and tech policy. But I think people are sort of neutral on it. I don't know if they'd have a preferred party, but I think there's a huge amount of opportunity. And so I think the role is for the movement on this one. And so, like, organizations like this one, what is the conservative policy on Bitcoin? What is the conservative policy on the gig economy? I mean, actually, to Aaron O'Toole's credit, there was some stuff on the platform about how supporting gig workers and that sort of thing. But like the future of work question is already having extraordinary impact. And because it's a new space policy area, no party has or political movement has a monopoly on it. And I think it's very naturally aligned for conservatives. And so doing work now and over the next like decade, so that 10 years from now, it is clear that the conservatives are the party of tech entrepreneurs and the future of work and all those big macroeconomic changes that are happening. Yeah. It's going to be people on the right of center media. It's going to be thought leaders attending conservative conferences. It's going to be young people pushing through the youth wing for this kind of policy to rise up to the top. It's going to be caucus members getting educated on it and pushing for it. And so I think there's a lot of opportunity there, but I think it's a medium or long-term play. And in the short term, it might not win us an election, but it's something the movement should focus on for sure.
Definitely. And even within those movement, I'm thinking broader in terms of industry associations, other organizations that, you know, peripherally will touch and can be vehicles to help share and spread sort of why maybe the conservative movement is a home for those entrepreneurs and young people who want to build something here in Canada and hire a bunch of people to do it too. So I'm cognizant of the clock here. So I'm wondering if maybe each of our panelists want to take a minute or so and sort of share some final parting takeaways and thoughts as we think about this broader conversation we've had on engaging younger audiences, both Gen Zs and millennials. Any takeaway lessons for the organizations, the political folks, and everyone in between that's listening in today? Maybe we can start with Kieran.
All right, sure, thank you. My main message for today is just to try your best to craft a very consistent narrative and consistent value base at all levels of government. I just think in this age where we're dealing with information overload and where it's clear the current kind of perception of the party needs to shift to some degree, obviously referring back to that word chart where the main word that was visible was old, that's something which can be changed. I think it's changed through consistent messaging from all levels of government and ultimately by crafting a smart narrative, which is shared across all levels, because if there's no consistency, then there's going to be very little retention of information. And that's, again, an environment where false narratives can thrive. So that's my main takeaway. And then also just to consider trying to humanize leaders by showing themselves in kind of the correct tone on these different platforms, because you can't door knock on everybody's door in Canada. But again, that kind of presents the opportunity to figuratively door knock and show the human side of the person at scale, which I really do think is important in shifting perceptions about kind of what a party leader looks like and who those people are in reality.
Love it. Ginny, did you want to jump in?
Sure. Yeah, I think if I could summarize my thoughts, it's don't try to be all things to all people. Look at the biggest growing generation in Canada, millennials and Gen Z behind them. Look at where they live in regions of the country where conservatives can and should do better, and present them with a differentiated view of the world that they can see in themselves and making their lives better. And pick some fights to do it, like whether it's on housing, where conservative policy should be about actually getting at the supply issue, or whether it's on, I mean, this is controversial to say, Bill 21, where the other political parties won't touch it, but opposing it on religious freedom grounds would totally align with conservative values and would be a real differentiator and news getter for conservatives. Pick a few of those big bucket areas, stand your ground, have the fight, and I think you'll find that young voters will behave like all other voters, and they'll unite behind a vision that will tell them that, you know, it can make a difference in their lives if they vote conservative.
Awesome. You want to close us out, David?
Well, I think those were great points. I'll just, very simple from my perspective, is find out what's keeping young people up at night and offer a conservative solution and vision to make sure they sleep better at night. I think it's not that simple, but because it's not simple to do, but it really aligns with that. And I think for my view is for maybe too long, at least from a young person's perspective, they didn't hear those answers to those things. And if you do that, you're not, again, to Ginny's point, you don't need to win 100% of them. You don't even need to win half of them to either agree with your issue or to vote for the party that you support. But if you're only getting 15 to 20%, given the size of this group, you can't win again. And so it becomes important just to find that audience, then that segment and connect with them.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for those points and for this discussion today, panelists. That was a great discussion, and I hope there were some takeaways there for our audience to think about how to better engage millennials and Gen Zs across the board here in Canada.